Thank you for this kind introduction. It's my second time in Egypt, and first time I stayed, it was like 14 hours, but this time I'll have the chance to do some sightseeing in your beautiful country. But first, the work. So I was invited to talk about heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, what is new in 2019. Now, okay. But before we go to 2019, we need to maybe take a look what can we derive from previous years. So how do we manage or how do we approach patients with heart failure, in particular with preserved ejection fraction? Now, so these are the 2016 guideline criteria for HFpEF. Now first, those are the patients that were in whom ejection fraction is higher than 50%. But then we also require some other parameters like elevated natriuretic peptides and also some structural and functional alterations of the heart. So the left atrium should be enlarged, or the left ventricular mass index enlarged. And also there should be some suggestions of the elevated pressures, filling pressures for the left ventricle. This is not completely in line what other associations think, because here are the criteria for left ventricular diastolic dysfunction, and I only am highlighting the panel which focuses on patients with that only focuses on patients with normal ejection fraction, because these are then the one with preserved. And here the parameters are slightly different. And this is also one of the associations within the ESC. Why this happens is beyond myself, but just to highlight that there are different opinions among the scientists and clinicians about how should we diagnose. Now, there was an interesting review published focusing on how many studies actually then compared these parameters with invasive hemodynamics. And in the end, what the, here you can already see that here are the ESC guidelines for diastolic function, and here is this document of the imagers. You can see that the parameter is different, and in this study what they have found, that only a very limited number of investigators actually looked into that. So association between filling pressures and echo parameters. And of the echo parameters, apparently, the best one is still the E over E prime, but the correlation is not perfect, average correlation of about 0.5. So in translation, we still don't know how to diagnose HFpEF adequately with the help of echocardiogram. Now there is another confusion in the field. This study compared 2.9 recommendations with 2.16 recommendations for diastolic dysfunction in general population. And you can already immediately appreciate that the proportion of diastolic dysfunction in 2.9 guidelines as compared to 2016 is completely different. If you would take the 2.9 criteria, then more than 1/3 would have diastolic dysfunction. If you would take 2016 recommendation, then 1% would have diastolic dysfunction. So really this is something where we don't know how to do it in the clinical practice. Before the one document I would mostly focus in my talk about the HFpEF diagnosis, we need to acknowledge this one. This was published last year in Circulation. It is the HFpEF score, and this group did derivation validation study of these parameters. So they had the clinical approach to HFpEF. If the sorry for that. So they derived the score with between that is ranking will be from 0 to 9, including if the patient is obese, if the patient is hypertensive, if the patient has atrial fibrillation, pulmonary hypertension, if the patient is old, at least 60 years old, and if the filling pressures are elevated. Now, if the patient has more than 5 points, then both in the model predicted and observed prevalence of HFpEF were close to 100%. So if somebody scored more than, excuse me, here is not enough space, oh, now it will go. So if somebody scores more than 5 points, then he or she more or less 100% has HFF. In HFA, we also worked on the criteria for HFF, and this is the document that took about 5 or 6 years to be published. Finally, it's published. It's called the HFA PEF diagnostic algorithm, and it combines, it is a stepwise algorithm with initial workup, diagnostic workup, advanced workup, and etiological workup to get to the final etiology, but it is immediately obvious that steps F1 and F2 are only for very advanced centers, or mostly they will be conducted in where you have really the equipment, possibilities, manpower to do it. But already the first two steps can separate the subjects that definitely don't have problems with diastolic function and no HFpEF, and the ones that most probably have. So with two steps, and it is the initial workup which is mostly available in every clinic, plus echo would then separate these two big groups, and then if you are still uncertain, then you need to take further steps like diastolic stress test, invasive hemodynamics, and then some specific imaging and other diagnostic techniques to be more certain whether the patient has HFpEF or no HFpEF. Now, focusing more into this echo part, because we are cardiologists and we are experts in echo, here they have defined major and minor criteria for functional morphological biomarker in sinus and AFib approach. So if you have a patient that has the LAVI above 34 milliliters per square meter, or left ventricular mass index slightly higher than I showed you from the guidelines, then this is the major criteria for HFpEF. Or if you are going to the biomarkers in sinus rhythm, NT-proBNP above 220, or BNP above 80, which is slightly higher than in the Paragon HF, you will see later how this one works. The minor criteria, those that are not so validated, like global longitudinal stress or LAVI that is still above, that is like including also the Paragon HF criteria. There are some difficulties with this algorithmic approach, with the criteria. And I would just highlight a couple of, and first obviously is natriuretic peptides. We know that natriuretic peptides depend on the body size, and they are also sex dependent. And we also know that if we have a heart failure patient, then there is the difference in body weight between men and women. And this needs to be also acknowledged and incorporated. Here is a nice study by Rudolf de Boer group from Groningen. They looked into sex-specific associations and obesity and NT-proBNP. And what it can be seen that for men and women, there is the difference in the peak in the NT-proBNP, and also what is important, that NT-proBNP is higher the lower the body weight. And this needs to be also then included into your diagnostic approach to patients with HFpEF. What is also important, that NT-proBNP may not be elevated at rest in your patients with HFpEF. You can see here that this cut point of 125, up to one third of HFpEF patients in whom HFpEF was confirmed on invasive hemodynamics, was still below 125. Because HFpEF patients usually have symptoms on exertion, and many don't have any symptoms at rest. And here we still don't know how to tease out this normal NT-proBNPs in these specific subgroups. This algorithmic approach, this score has been then validated. This is still online, it's not in the final version in European Journal of Heart Failure. So here you have the criteria per functional morphological biomarker and total criteria per then chance of HFpEF, and you can see that the score performs well overall. So if you have at least minor major criteria, then at least 2/3 of your patients will fulfill the criteria for HFpEF. And this also then translates into the prognostic value. Here we have the Kaplan-Meier survival curves per HFpEF, heart failure association PEF score being low, intermediate or high, and you can immediately appreciate that this is the hospitalization that patients that have high probability per this score definitely have worse prognosis than the other two groups. Now this was about the diagnostic part. There is still some uncertainty how to approach this. There are now more diagnostic tools available, but we still cannot be completely certain, like in HFrEF, that we have the cutoff and these are the patients with HFrEF. In HFpEF, it's a different ballgame, more phenotypes, more etiologies, and therefore it's more difficult also to define this in a very clear and straightforward way. Even though diagnostic criteria are not well developed, well accepted, there have been many studies conducted in the HFpEF population, as it was defined at its time, or in the individual study. And in this year, also the Paragon HF study reported at the ESC Congress in Paris. I'll walk you through the results. I believe you already know what has happened, but maybe if we take a look, maybe we can find some answers why did it went this way or why the study was neutral. Now this is the study design. It is quite similar than in paradigm. They also had the run-in period. This is quite a clever study design if you would like to have your study positive, but you then reduce the applicability for community, because here you exclude the patients that have either some high risk of side effects or would not tolerate the drug. This also happened in the Paragon, because the number of included patients you'll see was 2.5 times lower than the patients screened for the study. Now it also needs to be known how the patients got into the study. So there was the requirement of some age, ejection fraction higher than 45, symptoms, structural heart disease. They needed to have some evidence. We'll see. We'll take a closer look what were these criteria, and then with at least one of the following: either the heart failure hospitalization, and NT-proBNP higher than 200 for sinus rhythm and more than 600 for AFib. This is quite similar than the numbers that I've shown you previously. Or without hospitalization, the requirement for NT-proBNP was higher. Now, there is a separate paper that needs to be read if you would like to know which patients got in, and this is the rational design published in JACC Heart Failure. Here you have more information about the structural heart disease. You can see that left atrial enlargement was defined as at least one of the following. So either LA width higher or equal to 3.8, or length higher or equal to 5 centimeters, or area of 20 square centimeters of or volume of 55, or index volume higher than 29. And this is only the minor criteria by the heart failure association score. It's not the major. Usually also our colleagues echocardiographers say your left atrium volume index should be equal or higher than 34 to be indicative of diastolic dysfunction. So this could be regarded as the problem for inclusion. I couldn't find the proportion of patients that got in through that criterion, because in the current publication said, at least as far as I know, there is no proportion given how the patients got into the study. We could also discuss the anti-proBNPs. In the general population, you can see a wide scatter of natriuretic peptides, and it is still unclear whether this is sufficient to label your patients as heart failure candidates or even as HFpEF patients. The primary objective, obviously, was to evaluate the efficacy of sacubitril valsartan compared with valsartan in these patients, and the primary endpoint was composite of cardiovascular death and total heart failure hospitalizations. So this is not first heart failure hospitalization, but total number of hospitalizations, which is also quite different than in previous studies. So this is how the study went. You can see that more than 10,000 patients screened and almost 5,000 randomized. So half of the patients did not pass through the screen, through the run-in period. Now, but with close to 5,000 patients, still a significant study, they were then randomized into two arms, as stated previously. What is also important to see, and that is another paper that was published in Circ Heart Failure in last year, the comparison of run-in failure patients versus randomized patients. You can see that these run-in failures were older, in higher NOHA class, more were hospitalized with heart failure, more had NT-proBNP elevated, but the usual problems why they did not get in were the exclusion criteria usually linked with blood pressure or EGFR, but this may be indication of the sicker population. So maybe these should be included, and maybe then the study would be positive, but per study design they could not enter the study. These were the signs and symptoms at baseline in enrolled patients. Most of the patients dyspnea on effort. You can see dyspnea on effort, not at rest. Then fatigue, edema, autopnea. These were then the most common observed symptoms and signs of heart failure in patients that were enrolled in the study. This is a summary of baseline characteristics. Groups, as expected, well matched. Not unexpectedly, blood pressure in the normal range, mean body mass index at 30, so where we can already see the problems with NT-proBNP, creatinine was still in normal range, and EGFR in the 60 levels where you would expect in this group. Now, NT-proBNP was quite high. Now, the median was 900, and only 25% of patients had the NT-proBNP lower than like 470, which is good, telling us that actually most of the patients had significant elevation of NT-proBNPs. Also, the therapy in these patients, the patients were well managed before the study, most of the patients on whatever we considered they should be on. Now, you already know these Kaplan-Meier curves for primary endpoint. The study missed the primary endpoint by a very narrow margin, so p-value of 0.059. And this is the primary endpoint, but even if you go into the components of primary endpoint, none was significant. You could argue that this is really borderline, and these are the heart failure hospitalizations. Please remember that heart failure hospitalizations and the total number, not only the time to first, but the total number of heart failure hospitalizations, where there was no signal whatsoever in cardiovascular death. Now, here are the endpoints by in numbers. What needs to be observed is what was the absolute reduction, so it was 1.8. Event in 100 patient years, which could be considered as something that could be relevant for clinical practice. But still, we need to also remember p-value, which was not significant. Now, secondary endpoints, there was signal for improved health-related quality of life and NYHA. And no signal, and also for the renal composite endpoint. When there was primary endpoint analysis according to the pre-specified groups, then two subgroups somehow were obviously different than the others. Now, in the patients with in female patients, there could be some benefit, and also in the patients with lower ejection fraction, following the results of the paradigm heart failure. Okay. Safety, there was no significant signal for the safety problems with the exception of some hypertension, but we already see that from the, we already know that from the paradigm. And one important point that could be relevant for the interpretation of the results is that sacubitril valsartan was very effective in blood pressure lowering. Now, if we put that into the context, then Paragon overall was not a positive trial. There could be some signals in specific subgroups. Safety was okay. And if you then compare this with previous trials in HFpEF, there we still don't have anything for our HFpEF patients. Why is this so? Maybe this is the group is too heterogeneous. Maybe inclusion criteria were wrong. And now what do we have for our heart failure patients with preserved ejection fraction? All the studies negative. Maybe this is something that has the future. As far as I know, the largest HFpEF exercise trial has been submitted for review. Professor Edelman told me that, but still not published. But until then, what also needs to be acknowledged, and I'm going now back to the Paragon inclusion criteria. You remember the left atrial volume index was low. And I've shown you that drug is very effective in blood pressure lowering. And we also know that one composite of primary endpoint was really borderline positive, that were heart failure hospitalizations. So maybe, and this is my personal view, maybe what the drug did, that it prevented heart failure in patients that did not have heart failure. Because with this left atrial volume index, I don't know how many patients actually had this very low atrial left atrium volume index. Maybe this is the future for the sacubitril valsartan in the general population, even because we need to acknowledge that prevention of heart failure is something that we actually need to focus on, although we have good drugs now to treat heart failure, but only with reduced ejection fraction. So this is now my final slide, that we actually do know how to treat this group, we don't know how to treat this group, and maybe sacubitril valsartan on top of managing this group could be somehow moved to this group to manage blood pressure and then to prevent development of both of these conditions. And with this, I do thank you for your attention.